House Speaker Nancy Pelosi extends an invitation to the president, who is, quote unquote, mad as hell at her. Speaker Pelosi has just officially asked President Trump to give his annual State of the Union address. That's next February 4th. And it comes hours after reports of the president's anger about being in essentially impeachment limbo. This is what he tweeted. "I want an immediate trial!" Exclamation point. But both the House and the Senate cleared out of Capitol Hill for the holidays, so it's apparent the president is not going to get what he wants before Christmas. And that specifically is to know the House will actually be sending the two articles of impeachment to the Senate, triggering the impeachment trial. Speaker Pelosi has made it clear she has not done that yet, delaying the handoff while expressing concerns if senators will actually hold a fair trial. But Trump supporters, they are calling her out for being unfair. Here's more from Senate Judiciary Committee Chairman Lindsey Graham.
"I just left President Trump. He's mad as hell that they would do this to him and now deny him his day in court. The reason they're denying his day in, him his day in court, so they know their case sucks."
Well, one scholar is speaking out about Speaker Pelosi's delayed handoff. Harvard law professor Noah Feldman testified for the Democrats during the impeachment inquiry. And he says if the House doesn't send the articles over to the Senate, that means the president has not technically been impeached. Let me read for you what he wrote in Bloomberg. Quote, "If the House does not communicate its impeachment to the Senate, it hasn't actually impeached the president. If the articles are not transmitted, Trump could legitimately say that he wasn't truly impeached at all." So let's go straight to CNN legal analyst Ross Garber. He teaches impeachment law at Tulane Law School. And so, Ross, do you agree with his line of thinking that he wouldn't technically be impeached?
So this professor is very creative. He's a smart guy, very creative. But somehow the Speaker of the House and, you know, CNN and The New York Times and The Washington Post and virtually everybody on the planet somehow missed this. You know, the Constitution says that the House has the sole power to impeach. They passed articles of impeachment. The Speaker of the House said the president's impeached. You know, I don't think this argument, you know, while creative, really goes anywhere. Now, having said that, the Senate rules do say that the actual start of the trial is triggered by the delivery of the articles of impeachment and the appearance of House managers. So there's some argument there. But to be clear, the Senate is now fully in control of when this trial starts.
Okay, but just let me make sure so we're all on the same page. So because sources tell CNN that House Democrats, Senate Democrats are preparing for a trial as soon as the week of January 6th. But until the House actually hands over the articles, Russ, the Senate would still be at a standstill, correct?
Well, under the current rules. But remember, the U.S. Supreme Court said in very clear language in a case called Nixon versus United States, case of a federal judge's impeachment, said that the Senate is totally in control of its trial rules. And so right now, the Senate trial rules say exactly that, say that the trial doesn't start until managers appear and the articles are delivered. But the Senate could set a deadline for those things. They could also change the rules. They could also just act and dismiss the charges. But for right now, I think, you know, Senator McConnell and the Senate Republicans are fine to have this debate go on.
Okay. If you play it forward, waiting and holding on to the articles and, you know, essentially playing this game of who blinks first, what are some potential options of how this could play out on the Senate side once the articles are then handed over?
Yeah, so once the articles are handed over, and, you know, again, right now, you know, I think Senator McConnell and the majority and the Senate are fine to have this discussion go on. Once the articles are actually handed over, then that does trigger a number of procedural steps. But the big thing that we're looking for is the adoption of the rules and procedures to say how this trial is going to go. Mm-hmm. Right now, the Senate rules are very vague on how it all happens. Will there be witnesses? How many witnesses will there be? Will there be opening arguments? How long will the opening arguments go? In Clinton, the Senate adopted a set of rules that provided for long opening arguments, and only after those arguments did the Senate then turn to the question of whether additional witness testimony was necessary. And in the Clinton case, the Senate decided that no, there was going to be no need for live witness testimony, but they did provide for the taking of three depositions. So there are a lot of open questions about how this trial is actually going to happen, and that's what's being negotiated now.
We'll wait and see what they decide. Ross Garber, for now, thank you very much for, of course, all of your impeachment expertise. Despite President Trump's threats, meanwhile, that the economy would tank with his impeachment, Americans say it's actually been the best it's been in two decades, and the numbers prove it. Look at these numbers. A new CNN poll out today shows 76% of Americans think economic conditions are good. Only 22% think they're poor. That is the highest rating, by the way, since 2001. Add to that the fact that 55% of Americans approve of President Trump's trade deal between the U.S., Mexico, and Canada. That deal, USMCA is how it's referred to, just passed the House yesterday. And economic growth is ticking steadily upward. The latest GDP numbers show America's economy growing by 2.1% in the third quarter. So with me now, opinion columnist for the Washington Post and a CNN political commentator, Catherine Rampell. And so this week may not have been a highlight of President Trump's in his lifetime, but when you look at those numbers, and you're also thinking, all right, the election is about to be kind of like a blink away.
Yes.
If you are Democrats, are you shaking in your boots a little bit?
This is a challenge for them, right? Americans do rate the economy very strongly. In fact, the candidates were asked about this last night.
Yeah.
What is your message to America if the public is generally happy with where the economy stands now? Now, you could argue, as I and many others have, that presidents get too much credit when the economy is good, too much blame when the economy is bad. But the fact that I have to say that over and over again suggests it's not the most compelling argument politically. If you listen to what the candidates said, they basically argued that, look, economic growth has been pretty good, but the gains have not been equally shared. And there is poll data to suggest that that message could be a winning one amongst the American public overall.
So, because what I'm wondering, when you look at the 76% superficial level, obviously it's awesome for Americans in terms of jobs, but isn't there nuance in the sense that, all right, people may be employed, but they may not be thinking their economic situation is peachy, thus
right.
President Trump may not be the saving grace.
Right.
Correct?
So if you look at, for example, a recent poll from Pew Research Center, they asked people to evaluate the economy overall, but also do you think current economic conditions are helping the wealthy, helping the middle class,
yes.
helping the poor, et cetera? And most people said yes, they are helping the wealthy, but most people said no, they are hurting the middle class and they are hurting the poor. And about half of people said families like mine are not benefiting.
See,
families like mine
so significant.
Are being hurt. And in fact, even Republicans, a decent portion of Republicans said this, a plurality of lower income Republicans in this survey, which this was people earning under $40,000 a year, mm-hmm. said current economic conditions are hurting my family. Mm-hmm. So this suggests that there is kind of a toehold for Democrats to talk about this, to talk about the fact that wage gains have not really materialized. They're about the same in terms of year-over-year growth in inflation-adjusted terms today as they were before Trump took office. Mm. GDP growth, it's nothing to sneeze at. It's about 2%, but GDP growth averaged 2% during Obama's second term. So, and we spend, of course, $2 trillion on tax cuts for the wealthy in the meantime. So there is a narrative here that
yeah.
I think is borne by the facts that suggests that even if the overall numbers are good, they're not that much better or substantially different from those under Obama, and a lot of people feel like they're missing out.
I did want to ask you about the tax cuts just before we let you go, because you have been quite opinionated on how you feel about the Republicans and their tax cuts. And I'm just wondering, though, despite what you have certainly written about and spoken about, why isn't that reflected in the polls?
Because the tax cuts did not actually help the middle class and the poor that much. Most people got some amount of tax cut, but the amount was so small for the typical family that it wasn't really discernible from regular week-to-week fluctuations in their paycheck. It was heavily weighted towards the wealthy, towards corporations, which Americans even before this thought paid too little in taxes. Mm. And of course, a lot of the other promises that were made about them, that they would pay for themselves, that they would supercharge growth, that they would lead to raises, have not been borne out. So this was not the saving grace that Republicans claimed it would be, despite the fact that they are now arguing for even more tax cuts. This has not been a political winner for them.